Hello, this is Keith Kaiser with a word to the wise from the Gospel of Mark, reading in God's Word, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1 and verse 1, the beginning of the Gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Now, Mark is the shortest of the four Gospels, but it is packed with lots of truth that is helpful for knowing not only wisdom for this life, but also for the life to come, the age to come, or what we think of as eternal life. And you're going to go on somewhere forever. But if you don't know the Lord Jesus, I wouldn't call what will happen to you after you leave this planet eternal life. It's more like eternal existence. Because to leave this planet without the Lord Jesus is to be eternally lost and separated from God in the lake of fire. Of course, the Lord doesn't want that. That's what the Gospel of Mark is all about. Why he came to earth. Why God laid out this plan that was predicted in the Old Testament, as we'll see. And for centuries, he explained, he was a God who takes no delight in the death of the wicked. Rather, he sent his only Son into the world, as one of the more famous scriptures says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And of course, you recognize that as John 3:16. And the verse we've read in Mark just gets right into the action, and that's the sort of book Mark is. It's been said that the most important book, the most important word in the book is the word "and," because it tells you about one thing that the Lord Jesus did, and another thing he did, and another thing he did. And so you read words like and "but," and "immediately." These sort of words that carry us through the text and keep the action going. Now, I will be the first to readily admit I'm not strong at outlining books, and I'm grateful to the Lord for gifted teachers that he's given who've written books and given us help on the outlines of Scripture. I want to give you a broad outline of Mark just before we dive into the first verse. And the purpose of these meditations is not to be long, but to give you some bite-sized truth to mull over as you go about your daily activities. But a very able writer and teacher, R. Alan Cole, wrote in the New Bible Commentary an outline that I've found very helpful, and I'm going to share parts of it with you. He breaks down the book into three big sections, all pertaining to the kingdom of God. The first section is in Mark chapter 1, verse 1, through chapter 8, verse 26. Mark 1:1 through 8:26. And he calls that section of the book preaching the kingdom of God. Then the second section picks up where that previous section leaves off, Mark 8:27 through 10:52. Chapter 8, verse 27 through chapter 10, verse 52. He calls that the cost of the kingdom of God. And then the final section of the book, chapter 11, verse 1, through the end of the book, chapter 16, verse 20, he says, bringing in the kingdom of God. So that's Mark 11, 1 through 16, 20, bringing in the kingdom of God. Now, in those bigger sections, of course, he has smaller breakdowns of each passage. And the one that's relevant to our studies this week is that he tells us about the first 20 verses, Mark 1, verses 1 through 20. He calls that foundations of the kingdom of God. And of course, everything that is going to happen in the establishment of God's kingdom on earth, which is still future, the Lord, of course, is in control of history. The Lord, in one sense, is sovereign and reigning over all. But in another sense, as Hebrews 2 reminds us, we don't see everything put under man and put under God in the sense that not everything is bowing to God's authority and obeying him in the way it should. If everything were submitting to God in the way it ought, we wouldn't be dealing with wars and rumors of wars. We wouldn't have the problems of human selfishness and wickedness that we not only face on a global scale, but which touches every one of us individually, because none of us can say, I'm free of that problem of sin. We need to come to the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation and for the work of God in our lives to utterly deliver us from that sin. He, of course, is going to save us from the future punishment of sin if we put our faith in him. And he is also going to save us from the power of sin. He's working on believers already day by day to help us grow in the faith and to exhibit the fruit that he produces through our lives by his Holy Spirit. And one day we're going to be delivered from the very presence of sin. That will be a wonderful day that'll happen when Romans 8 speaks about the redemption of the body. When the Lord, in other words, comes to pick up what he has purchased with his own blood, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, Ephesians 1:7 says. Now we get back to Mark and we notice how Mark doesn't begin the way Matthew does, nor does he begin the way Luke or John does. He's unique. He's his own man. And the Holy Spirit gave Mark not simply as some kind of reduction of the gospel, but he's conveying his truth in a special way, with a particular vantage point. And he doesn't begin with a genealogy like Matthew does. Matthew's interested in establishing the Lord as the King of Israel. And that claim as King of Israel, by the way, isn't parochial. In other words, it doesn't restrict the blessing to Israel alone. But time and time again, Matthew tells us that this king has come to minister to the Gentiles as well. And there's a lot about the Lord reaching out to Gentiles in the gospel according to Mark as well. Now, when we get to Luke, we get a story not about the Lord Jesus initially, but about the some of his relations in the more broader sense, friends and family of his mother. And they are, of course, the story of Zacharias and Elizabeth and how the forerunner, John the Baptist, the one who is the promised voice that's going to come. And Mark addresses that voice in Mark chapter 1, verse 2. But Luke gives us the story of how his miraculous birth came about and of the events that led to the incarnation of the Lord Jesus Christ, how he came and was brought into this world voluntarily and in fulfillment of Scripture by coming into the womb of a virgin. John, of course, goes back before either of those Gospels. It goes back before any of the four. It says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." So John likewise begins in a terse and simple fashion, but he wants to emphasize for us the eternality of the Lord, how this is the eternal Word, co-equal with the Father and the Spirit, always with God the Father, always towards him, and always, therefore, in complete fellowship with him. But the Word became flesh, as John 1:14 tells us, and tabernacled, or pitched his tent, or in simpler English, dwelt among us. Now, Mark tells us here, in the beginning, rather, not in the beginning, but the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And it would be good for a moment just to pause and take stock of what that word gospel indicates. Gospel is glad tidings or a good announcement or a little more simply good news. And this is what the word was. It's the word from which we eventually get our English word evangelical. Originally, an evangelical was a person who loves the gospel. I realize, unfortunately, today it's been sullied. A lot of people associate it with politics or with different philosophies of men or different positions that may or may not be scriptural. But generally speaking, when we talk about evangelical or someone who is evangelical, I like the original meaning. This is a gospel man or a gospel woman or a gospel boy or a gospel girl. Someone who loves the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. And the beginning of this gospel gets right to the fact that this one is coming not to be a king, not to be even a priest, although he is those things in the economy of God, the way God works. But Mark is going to emphasize, of course, the Lord Jesus as a servant. And when someone wants a servant, they don't delve back many generations in their family tree and say, "Now, do you have a legal right to be a servant?" You'd do that for a king. You'd do that to say, "Could you sit on the throne?" But when Mark begins, he just says the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Full stop. That's what we need to know. This is good news about the Lord Jesus. It's his good news. And apart from Christ, you don't have the good news. There's no such thing as good news in the eternal sense of that term without the Lord Jesus. He's the one who died so that heaven could be opened to us. He's the one who died so that we could have eternal life. That is a relationship with our Creator, the living God. He's the one who rose again to prove that death itself has been vanquished and that perfect love casts out fear, as the scripture says. The Lord Jesus is the one who makes good news, makes a gospel possible. And he's, of course, called here the Son of God, not a Son of God as if he's one among many, but this is the unique. John 3:16 calls him the only begotten Son. And John 1, earlier than that, says, the only begotten who is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him, speaking of God the Father. He's the one who has demonstrated exactly who God is. And so this one who comes, it was a real man, was a human being, in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin, says the book of Hebrews chapter 4. He's the one who's a real human being, but with no sin nature, because he was not partaker of that fallen nature of the first Adam. His was a holy humanity created in the virgin womb, totally sin apart, and he demonstrated through his life that in him was no deceit, that in him was no tarnishment of sin, that he never did any sin, never spoke anything that was sinful, nor did he even think anything that was sinful. Our Lord Jesus was absolutely holy, perfect, and we might say impeccable, incapable of sinning. So this is the gospel, and Mark is going to tell us about it. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The first thing you've got to know is he's not merely a man, but this is the Son of God. This is the one equal with the Father from eternity, equal with the Spirit. This is the one who has come and taken on humanity for the express purpose of dying for us and rising again to pay for our sins and to satisfy the righteous claims of our Maker, the holy and living God, and to please him in all things. And we'll see in Mark that that's precisely what the Lord does. I hope you know him, and if not, we pray that you will consider these studies and go on to come to know him for yourself.